lovelies, Cuckoo here with another Hogwarts House cast look. Today we are doing Ravenclaw, and I created this series as an excuse to talk about Hogwarts Legacy, and I've actually been playing. I'm about 100 hours into the game, although a goodly portion of that is just letting the small children in my life run around and catch magical creatures. I really love that you can switch difficulty like right in the middle of the game, and the story mode is so easy that when I hand the controller to a 4-year-old, they don't die, and it's amazing. Like, I was playing on hard and I fought a troll, and then I switched to story mode and handed it to my nephew and he defeated a troll and he was so excited. I do think my older nieces I'm gonna switch to at least easy, if not like normal, because they're good enough to play at a higher level. But the game's still tricky. You have to like press multiple buttons at the same time and like, you know, there's different combinations. And so I feel like it's a really good way to like teach kids video games, which is kind of my job as the aunt. Introducing children to video games is what I do. And I didn't expect this game to be so kid friendly. My friend's 4-year-old the other day told her mom, "I want to go over to our friend's house and play magic." And her mom was like mixing potions, because that's what my mom's been doing with her, like making bath bombs and stuff and then, you know, putting it in a cauldron to make potions. It's super cool. But she was like, "No, the magic video game." And she just wanted to come catch magical creatures. I really like that aspect of Hogwarts Legacy. You collect magical creatures to rescue them from poachers, and then you put them in the room of requirement and like tend to them, and you get like magical ingredients from them. It's really fun. It's really cool, but kind of like a side part of the game. But for little kids, it is the game. And listening to my friend's 4-year-old giggle her little head off as the Neasels ran around after a ball of yarn was amazing. Another time, Lexi, Sadie, and I were playing, and Sadie learned that you could cast Levioso on the magical creatures and it would make them fly. And so she just kept doing that, and Lexi and I were cracking up so hard. It was amazing. This game really is super magical. That's an obvious word to use, but like, it's real. But I've actually been playing through the main story. I've completed all except one of the relationship quests. I think I have one more with Sebastian, which I'm excited about. His story has gotten intense. It's kind of emotional. I really like it, but like, whew. Natty's story got kind of heavy too, and I really liked it. I've actually finished that one, and the ending was really good. And then I actually only have one more main story quest. And I got to the point where, like, one of the characters was like, "I hope it's not too late. We have to go." And he, like, ran towards this door. And I was like, "Cool. But I have, like, one more sliding block puzzle to complete." And so I just, like, flew powdered out of there. So he's still standing and waiting for me while I wrap up a few little things. I have almost 100% of the game, except for learning the Unforgivable Curses. I'm not doing that this run. I'm playing as a good guy. I am going to play as an evil Ravenclaw soon. And today I am showing you my evil Ravenclaw sim. She came out interesting. I'm not really sure what the vibe is. I knew I wanted like really pale skin, black hair, and blue eyes. And that was pretty much all I knew going into this. And I had this vague idea that I wanted like elegance. I cannot say that without hearing the guy from Spy Family. But elegance is hard to pull off in The Sims without going like super, super formal. And I actually wound up with more of a like cozy vibe. I kept finding like full outfits, like dresses or overalls and things that were blue and bronze. And so I used those and it wound up with like almost a cottagecore-y vibe. But I still wanted her to be evil. And I kind of liked the idea of this like cute, cozy bookworm who like is plotting global domination. I really like this character. I named her Violet Edgecombe because, again, I have to carry on naming all of my Hogwarts characters after someone from their house. Marietta Edgecombe is a really interesting character to me. We don't really get to know her. She's kind of just this random kid who betrays the DA. But thinking about her, I actually have some sympathy. Like, I don't begrudge what Hermione did. It was a little vindictive, but it was very Hermione. And I think Marietta deserves some retribution. What she did was horrible. But I also was thinking about it, and I'm like, she probably doesn't realize how high the stakes are. Like, she doesn't realize they're actually at war. A lot of people at this time don't even believe that Voldemort has come back. In fact, like, most people. And yeah, we've seen some more evidence of it by the time she betrays the DA, but, like, she's 15. To her, this is just, like, some school group going against the headmistress. I don't know, it's interesting to me. And, like, Cho says, you know, she's a lovely person who made a mistake. And, like, again, I totally get Harry just being furious about that. Because, like, Umbridge was gonna torture him. This is really serious, but Cho and Marietta are kind of outside of that. I don't know. I found it really interesting. And I actually really like Cho as a character too. We just see the story so much through Harry's lens, right? So we have a very like limited viewpoint, which is very realistic. We all see life that way. But for Marietta and Cho, this is a completely different story. And I like that. I find it interesting. But I did name my evil Ravenclaw character after her because, you know, she was the only evil Ravenclaw I could think of. And I just like the sound of Violet Edgecombe. I don't really know where I got Violet. Like, I know that the fat lady's friend is named Violet. They go drinking together. That's like all I got for that character. I just really like the sound of it. That's all. And I think she came out pretty kind of different. I did really like her formal wear, although it's the only one that doesn't have bronze on it. It kind of reminded me of the like dark arts robes from the game, even though like this obviously isn't like an evil look. It kind of leaned into that a little more than her other looks that are really just cozy. I don't know, it's a weird vibe. I definitely didn't have like a super specific aesthetic going in, but I think it's cohesive and I like her a lot. I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on this look as we are coming up on the end now.
They had a dream to teach all that they knew. Witches and wizards came from. And it grew till the castle stood tall by the shores of a lake. And a thousand years later, the magic remains.
So that is Violet Edgecombe, my evil Ravenclaw. What did you think? Especially if you're a Ravenclaw, what did you think of this aesthetic? Do you have a different idea of what a Ravenclaw aesthetic might look like? Let me know. I would love to do more Ravenclaw looks, as well as the other houses. So sound off whatever your house is. Let me know what kind of style you think fits your house. Anyway, that's all for today. Next time, I'm going to be doing Gryffindor House, so keep an eye out for that. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next episode. Bye!